Welcome, I'm Glen Anderson, producer and host of this TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives. This series explores a wide variety of issues related to peace, social and economic justice, the environment, and nonviolent social change. We especially provide opportunities for the public to hear voices and viewpoints that are rarely heard in mainstream media. Mainstream media, politicians, and culture see the world in conventional ways. The establishment is stuck in how they see the world. In order to solve problems, we need to see things differently. This TV series, Glen's Parallax Perspectives, can help us see things differently so we can solve problems at all levels, from the local to the global. This series is called Glen's Parallax Perspectives. Here's what the word parallax means. Put one finger in front of your nose and another finger farther away. Close one eye, then open that eye and close the other. Your fingers will seem to move. This is called a parallax view. This TV series invites you to look at issues from fresh perspectives. Also, see much information about the issues that we cover in this TV series and previous episodes of this series at my blog, www.parallaxperspectives.org. And now I invite you to watch this month's program. Hi, this month's interview on Glen's Parallax Perspectives will bring us up to date on the rapidly changing crisis of nuclear weapons. We're facing some seriously increased dangers, but also people are working against nuclear weapons, and we've made progress on that. So during this hour, we'll bring you up to date on both the dangers and the opportunities. Three guests will help us explore the topic. All four of us are very active members of the new Olympia Coalition to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. Bob Delastrada has been working for peace and social justice in a variety of ways. Mark Fleming is a Vietnam veteran who has also been working for peace, especially through Veterans for Peace. Tim Russell currently teaches at the college level. He has a long and deep knowledge of nuclear weapons. Welcome, I'm glad that we are all here and we'll have a good time while we talk about some substantive things. For many decades, the United States has maintained thousands of nuclear weapons that could be launched in any of three ways: a huge arsenal of land-based nuclear missiles, nuclear missiles that can be launched from submarines, and nuclear bombs that could be dropped from airplanes. Bob, can you tell us why the United States government is planning to replace all of our nuclear weapons with totally new ones?
Well, there's a historical precedent to it. President Obama had made an arrangement to the New START Treaty, that's it. Yeah, the New START Treaty, and it was agreement with Russia that both sides would reduce their strategic weapons to 1,500 apiece. And the Congress would go along with that, providing that the weapons were modernized. And so President Trump inherited that situation. And so then the cost of the weapons was high, very high.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen estimates like more than $1 trillion over the next 30 years or
Well, actually, it was originally pitched as $1 trillion. The actual reality with inflation is $1.2 trillion. And if you bring in add-ons and delays in production, mm-hmm. you get about $1.7
billion.
Trillion.
Trillion. Yeah. $1.7 trillion. And then if you add on the ancillary costs, the cost of cleaning up the nuclear waste, uh-huh. and everything that goes along with producing weapons, you can add on another $500 billion. Uh-huh. So the reality is that you're looking at over $2 trillion, uh-huh. perhaps 2.2, $2.3 trillion.
Yeah. Well, that's good. We can cut your Social Security to pay for that.
Well, that's the thing.
And food stamps and cut health care and cut education. And,
well, that's the problem, that even if these weapons are not used, even if they were never used, they do a lot of damage in the sense that they take away funds that could be used for housing, education, health care.
Anything else to add from anybody else here, Mark?
Well, actually, I would add, you know, it takes that money away and it's invested in something that's really not productive. You have a bomb. It doesn't flow out into the economy and create jobs. So if you invest in infrastructure, that $2 trillion, you have a much more modernized transportation system.
Yeah,
and that's an opportunity cost that we have by investing in weapons like this.
If you invest in education, you get a better educated population. If you invest in healthcare, you have healthier people. And but this is a negative.
Here we just get a bomb. You know, we can drop it and explode it and create some more jobs to build another one, but it doesn't really help the economy.
Yeah, it's capital intensive. It's not as labor intensive. Mm-hmm. There's been reports that have said that if the money was funneled towards education, that there would be twice the jobs. Mm-hmm. So it's really not about jobs like it's billed to be. On a positive note, I understand that that threshold has been reached, the 1,500, and then we should maybe specify that there's three levels, three statuses of warheads. There's the active, the, what do you call it?
Reserve?
Yeah. And then there's a third level, so there's different numbers. It doesn't mean that that's all we have.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, you see different numbers quoted, and it depends on whether they're counting all of them or the ones that are ready to go at a moment's notice or...
Yeah, the 1,500 are the hair trigger ready to go.
Yes,
yeah.
The active.
Yeah, we currently have about 7,000 in the stockpile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And like you say, 1,000 to 1,500 are on hair trigger alert.
Yeah. And another portion of it can be put on hair trigger pretty quickly.
Yeah.
They would be the second strike, I guess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, and when we talk about the cost, one of the things that you told me when we were preparing for the interview is something that I had known from before, which is that the prime contractor tries to do subcontracting and sub-subcontracting out into every congressional district they can, so that you end up with all these Congress members saying, oh, this, you know, we should fund this multi-billion dollar weapon because that'll be five jobs in my district to this machine shop down the street or
well,
something.
Well, it's not just the military-industrial complex anymore. It's the military-industrial-congressional complex.
Right.
Because of the interplay between all those three different groups.
Yeah, they're also, besides being co-opted for the jobs, even though there are more jobs elsewhere, as Tim says, but they're also being funded for their campaigns by the weapons manufacturers. Mark, I want to check in with you about something about this, what's referred to as the Nuclear Posture Review, which hardly anybody knows about. But on February 2, 2018, the Trump administration released their Nuclear Posture Review, and this is the document that lays out how the Trump administration and the Pentagon, who actually wrote this for the Trump administration, understand the role of nuclear weapons and when to use them and all of that. Previous nuclear posture reviews were issued in 2010, 2002, and 1994. You've read a lot of this document, and before we get into the specifics, what's your overall assessment of the 2018 version?
That overall assessment is it does change our U.S. nuclear posture dramatically from the previous one in 2010. Previously, we said we would not use nuclear weapons against any country that signed the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. So we would not, but now we have changed it that we will use nuclear weapons under a variety of circumstances, including non-nuclear attacks. So they've expanded, I guess, the range of the scope of using nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
So again, we might use them more frequently or more readily.
Yeah.
So that's one. And then also the idea that we are going to build some new ones, new types of nuclear weapons, much smaller. And those create problems because they're smaller, they're more accurate, and they may lead our adversaries to think we better strike first.
Right. There's this game of chicken.
Yes.
You know, it's you know, people remember the old teenagers driving head on at each other down a highway, and whoever, you know, pulls aside is the chicken.
Right.
And we've got this nuclear chicken we've been doing for all these years, and the pressure now is even more frightening than it had been.
This is the idea that, you know, we have these really large nuclear weapons, megatonnage, that would, you know, obliterate whole cities and portions of countries. Well, we can't use those. They're too big to use for some of these smaller problems. We need to be more flexible, more supple. So now they're talking about we want to use nuclear weapons. And this really isn't anything new. We've talked about tactical weapons in the 50s. Yeah. We had an atomic cannon that could shoot a 15-kiloton warhead. That's considered a small, low-yield weapon. We had the Pershing missiles in the 80s with Ronald Reagan. So it seems to come around every so often.
Yeah, and it seems to come from the people who want to be able to use these. They have to find the technology that they can build and the rationale to make it seem usable.
Yes.
As if that were a rational.
And the rationale is that we're going to build these things so that our deterrent is credible, and we're going to tell our adversaries that first use is just a no-go. It's you're not going to achieve your objectives, you're going to be annihilated. And to do that, we reserve the right to use it first.
Yeah.
So we have an exception for ourselves, but not our adversaries.
Yeah, and the rest of the world sees that hypocrisy. Yeah.
Right. And then we have these adversaries. We are, you know, you read the Nuclear Posture Review, and we have Russia, we have China, we have Iran, we also have the non-state terrorist groups. So all these are, you know, these are threats. Mm-hmm. And they talk about Russia being more aggressive. They talk about China, you know, pushing into the South China Sea. So we are going, this is a danger to us that we might want to respond with nuclear weapons. You know, confirm that, you know, support our allies, you know, the allies in the South China Sea that are challenging China. It has to be credible. If we can't use our big nukes, then what good are we?
Well, you know, the South China Sea is a lot closer to China than it is to the United States.
It's funny how that works.
Yeah, and they feel the need to protect their immediate geographic interests. Yeah.
And we have interest in the sense of navigation of international waters, but then maybe we have interests, maybe some are conflicting, and maybe we should be talking about this as opposed to aiming missiles at each other.
Yeah.
I think more than anything else, I mean, I talk about it being a dramatic change, but in one respect, this is nothing new. This has been our nuclear posture since 1945.
Yeah.
Well, this is the thing is, in the Nuclear Posture Review, there's nothing about negotiation. And there's nothing about open channels of communication. It's just more nukes to protect us.
Yeah.
I was looking at the videotape today of the Nuclear Posture Review, and they open it with saying, our job is to protect you. Your safety is our most important concern. So, and then they go on to lay out the scenario of using more nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
So it's probably, I don't know if this is completely accurate, but it was probably developed by war planners in the Pentagon, and it wasn't an interagency effort.
In fact, I mean, the whole posture review tends to downplay our diplomacy, which is especially dangerous in the Trump administration, where we have a State Department that's hollowed out. We don't have an undersecretary for the Far East, for the Korea area.
Right.
So we don't have people on the ground that understand the situation, and they can start looking for where are the areas of mutual interest? Because actually, we in North Korea, we in China, we in Russia all have mutual interests. Mm-hmm. We also have conflicting interests.
Yeah.
And it doesn't make sense to say, well, we have to go to war. I mean, that's been our posture. And I think that's one of the things I find most distressing.
Right. It's the old saying that says if your only tool is a hammer, you're going to treat every problem as if it were a nail. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then to point out how old this is, in 1958, the sociologist C. Wright Mills referred to I've forgotten the actual quote now.
The crackpot realism.
Crackpot realism. What that was, Pentagon war planners justifying, you know, creating fears that justify stockpiling weapons of mass destruction. And that's what these are, even small ones.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this small nuclear, was it one-third of a, no, yeah, three-tenths of a kiloton. That's still 600,000 pounds of TNT.
Yeah,
that's radiation.
So things that were the size of the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombs are now being referred to as small or low yield, and look at what they did there.
And I've seen an estimate where they kind of game out, well, what would happen in a limited nuclear exchange? Yeah. Maybe 5 or 10 warheads, but that can create what they describe as not nuclear winter, but nuclear autumn, which has that could have devastating effects.
Yeah. So really, really shade out the, there's so much ash and debris in the atmosphere that it shades out where the sunlight that plants need for growing.
And the temperature would drop.
Temperature.
Well, and the idea that there could be a limited nuclear war, I mean, when that threshold is breached, it's kind of, you know, all bets are off.
That's right.
Who's to say that somebody doesn't lob a larger? And then who is in the position to evaluate the size of the nuclear weapon to justify whether they should launch something of similar kilotonnage across? I mean, you know, once that kind of weapon of mass destruction is used, then all bets are off.
Maybe we can talk a little about the types of weapons that are going to be replaced or modernized. They're talking about getting all new MX missiles, or
land-based.
ICBMs. Land-based. Yeah. So that would be about 400 new ICBMs plus 50 in reserve.
And also, each ICBM would have multiple warheads.
I'm not sure on that.
Typically, those are the big ones.
Yeah, those are the big ones. But then there's also 1,000 cruise missiles,
the long range standoff missiles.
Right. Yeah.
And then they're talking about 80 to 100 B-21 bombers that would use the B-61
gravity bomb. And that would be a third of a kiloton or up to 340 kilotons. They're also talking about 12 nuclear submarines, I believe are the Columbia-class submarines.
Right.
And those would have like 20 missile tubes, and I think those missiles have as many as 8 warheads.
And they're talking about putting some of the smaller warheads on some of those submarines.
Right. So if they are launched, the adversary, or the whoever they're being sent towards, will not really know if this is a city buster or just a smaller one. Mm-hmm. So the possibility of retaliation is increased.
Yeah. There's another thing that we've talked about in the past, but I don't think it's come up here, about the occasion of when the Trump regime would want to do nuclear weapons. That's even if there's some... somebody else does some cyber attack on our computer systems, and I mean that takes a conventional thing and escalates it into nuclear. But the screwy thing about computer warfare kinds of things is you don't know where some computer thing came from. So you know, maybe Pakistan does something and they bounce it through Canada. And we think, oh, this came from Canada, and we nuke Canada when it came from Pakistan. Or they route it through Pennsylvania, and what are you going to nuke Pennsylvania, you know? But you can, these computer things get bounced from different places, and you don't know where they really initiated.
And it really does conflate nuclear and non-nuclear war.
That line has been blurred.
Yeah. And it's lower. It claims to be raising the threshold for nuclear war, when in fact it's lowering it for us.
Yeah, it makes it more likely that somebody is going to do something really stupid, and that puts us all. These things don't protect us, like you said. The video says, "Oh, this is all about protecting you." No, it's endangering us.
Paying more for less protection.
Yeah, and so we need to know that these folks are putting us at risk. At the end of this interview, I'll mention how people can find lots of sources of information. I'm going to put a lot of information sources on the blog, and I'll tell people how to find that. Mark, a few minutes ago, you talked about the Nuclear Posture Review allowing Trump to launch nuclear weapons in more kinds of situations, and the new, more usable nuclear weapons. Is there anything else you want to add to that? The notion of a limited nuclear war, we've touched on this.
I mean, it's somewhat of an oxymoron, because you don't know what's going to happen. You know, we think, okay, we're going to fire one nuclear weapon. And the idea is that, okay, something is really going bad. We need to stop it. will fire one nuke. You don't know that there's not going to be a response.
Yeah, of one or two or three or a dozen or a hundred.
And for that matter, even one, if it's big enough, I mean, if it's a Hiroshima-type bomb, it's going to put out going to create massive destruction, put out a radioactive plume, and certainly for that particular area, it's going to cripple their ability to respond.
Yeah.
We saw that in Hiroshima, where it took out the hospitals, a lot of the medical providers.
Yeah, and people often don't stop to think that if you get a lot of radiation in the atmosphere, it's going to blow around and come back at us again.
Yes.
So we're going to get irradiated from our own radiation. It's not something where it's just constrained within the national boundaries.
So the idea that somehow this is all under control, because once you start firing, there's really, the certainty just disappears.
Yeah.
Well, and that's your point about the radiation is also about how it's such an inhumane weapon. I mean, you know, nobody's going to say it's a humane weapon, but it's the fact that civilians are just going to be slaughtered.
Yeah.
And civilians that you maybe aren't even intending to harm through wind blowing radiation are harmed. So it's a terrible weapon.
Yeah. To put civilian populations at risk when we did not sign up for this. It was one thing if, like you're a Vietnam combat veteran, people do join the military. Sometimes they get drafted, although not lately. But if you join, you know what you're getting into. But if ordinary people who don't sign up to become targets are made targets by the reckless governments.
And that's both our adversaries as well as us.
Yeah. I want to mention something about North Korea, which has been in the news a lot since mid-2016. The American politicians and news media have been expressing fear about North Korea's recent work on nuclear weapons. And Trump especially has been reacting in ways that don't show a real understanding of the situation. And Trump's reaction just further threatened North Korea and increase the danger of nuclear war. Anytime that you have a conflict with somebody, a good starting point is to start by figuring out how does this other person see the conflict? And the United States does not do that. We never considered in various countries or non-country participants that we've dealt with how they see things. The Korean War never ended. There's a ceasefire, but there never was a peace treaty. And so technically, we've been at war continuously for 65 years with North Korea. And the United States has been continually threatening North Korea, including threatening them with nuclear weapons, for 65 years. And imagine how that's like on their receiving end of those threats. And so we have to understand that they feel threatened. They have their own national security concerns because the United States already has used nuclear weapons twice on Japan. And we've been overthrowing governments in lots of parts around the world, but the only governments we've overthrown have been those that did not have nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
And so it makes perfect sense from North Korea's standpoint that since the United States has been threatening them for 65 years continuously, the only way to protect themselves is nuclear weapons, from their standpoint. Mm-hmm. And so when Trump keeps threatening them, that just reinforces their anxiety and motivate them to build more and test more. So the remedy is not to keep threatening and to escalate the threats, but for all nations to abolish nuclear weapons, which is what we're all about.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll talk about efforts toward that direction. But I just want to make sure that the viewers think about the North Korea crisis from North Korea's standpoint.
And one other thing that North Korea brings to this is what happened during the Korean War when we totally devastated North Korea to the point that the Air Force said they had no targets left to bomb.
Yeah.
Dean Rusk said any two bricks that were stacked together, we blew up. Uh-huh. So they remember that.
Yeah. Yeah. And like I said, you know, anytime you have a conflict with somebody, try to understand how it's like from the other person's standpoint.
Yeah, we preach empathy interpersonally, But in terms of international relations, empathy is not a word that you'll hear much. I think another thing that's really important is the exercises, the military exercises that we conduct with South Korea.
Yeah, and war games.
War
we
games,
call them.
Right? And they include what's the word for cutting off the head of the
decapitating.
So they have included those scenarios, which is, of course, you know, something to be concerned if you're the leader in that country. You know, North Korea has its problems, certainly, but it's absolutely true that we are doing everything possible to put them in a defensive position.
And both of these two countries have psychiatrically distorted people at the top. And all they do is reinforce each other. For somebody to say my button is bigger than your button is like an adolescent boy or a pre-adolescent boy taunting another adolescent or pre-adolescent boy.
Well, and
we need some grown-ups.
And imagine some of the biggest military exercises that happen anywhere on the planet happening right off of our shore. How would we respond to that? Yeah. So my understanding is that during the period that the Olympics are happening is one of the times, the only times in the calendar that we're not conducting some of these exercises.
Yeah.
So thank goodness for the Olympics. And that there's been this start of talks with South Korea.
Within South Korea, the people really don't want to have war. Ethnically, all of the Korean people are one and the same ethnic group. The North and South line is just an artificial line. And people in the North and people in the South, they have relatives on the other side. And they've not been able to see each other for a long, long time. But it's all one nation, and people on both sides want to reunite. There's another country that I want to mention. Again, it's like we got to see how they see things. Trump has been irrationally trying to provoke a totally unnecessary war with Iran. And a few years ago, several nations used diplomacy with Iran to eliminate Iran's ability to create nuclear weapons, which they had been considering. And they worked out a deal that stopped Iran's effort to build nuclear weapons, and it's called the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, JCPOA. It's multilateral. It was worked out by seven nations. Iran and the U.S. while Obama was president, and also France, Germany, United Kingdom, Russia, and China. So all these powerful nations got together and said, let's work out a deal to solve the problem. And by any reasonable assessment, it's been working just great.
And isn't Iran a signatory to the non-proliferation treaty?
I believe so, but I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't be surprised. Trump doesn't like it, but it really has been working well. And the only people who don't like that Iran nuclear deal are the people who just always want to have another war. But Trump can't reject it unilaterally without antagonizing all of the other nations that had achieved this
together.
Peace agreement. Right.
Several of them are the allies that we're so concerned about in our nuclear posture.
Right. But Trump is stiffing them and not supporting their efforts for peace. And every international problem needs diplomacy, not threats of war. And this was a good example of diplomacy. And you can contrast that with what George W. Bush did when he started a war against Iraq in 2003 with the false claim that Iraq was making nuclear weapons, even though the evidence showed, no, they're not. And George W. Bush chose war instead of diplomacy. And we're still fighting that war, you know, 15 years later.
And then we're fighting the organization that came into the power vacuum after we left.
So we overthrew Iraq's government, and terrorist groups came up, and that spread. So Bush's war has provoked terrorism throughout that whole region, whereas with the Iran deal, the responsible nations were able to get together and create an agreement.
And in addition to the hardliners in the U.S. that want, you know, nuclear war, you also have the hardliners in Iran.
Yeah,
so it really gives you know, pulling out of it supports their message.
Exactly, it eggs them on. It's like this North Korea thing where you egg each other on. And just some other interesting contrast between Iran and the United States. Iran has never had nuclear weapons, but the United States has 7,000, mm-hmm. And has used them twice. Iran is not violating the Non-Proliferation Treaty, but the United States has been violating it
since
1970, yeah. When it went into effect. Iran spends about $300 per capita on the military, but the United States spends almost seven times that much per capita on the military. Iran has zero foreign military bases. The United States has more than 800 foreign military bases. Iran has never started any war for the last couple centuries, and the United States has started and invaded, 70 or more. Iran has never overthrown the U.S. government, but the United States and Britain overthrew Iran's government. They had a democracy in 1953, and we overthrew their democracy and installed the Shah, this dictator.
They elected the wrong person.
Yeah. Anyway, so I mean, the rest of the world sees this, but in the U.S., we have the politicians and the news media who give us the propaganda, and it's just like clouding over our eyes. We can't see what's going on.
And if you're an American and you've traveled anywhere and talked to people from other countries, one of the things that you always hear is that we know much about the United States, but many Americans don't know anything about us.
Yeah.
If you show any interest or knowledge of their country, that's different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Tim, tell us about the doomsday clock. This was in the news lately. Tell us. Yeah. It's a famous indicator of how close we are to destroying ourselves.
Yes. People are maybe familiar with the doomsday clock. It seems like that gets pretty good press for at least a day or two every year that time comes around for them to contemplate moving it. It's a board of scientists, of which there's Nobel laureates. It was started by some of the scientists that were instrumental in the construction of the first nuclear weapons. And so a very prestigious organization, and they have moved the minute hand from 2.5 minutes, which is where it was last year, to 2 minutes.
And the 2.5 was the closest it had been to midnight for
nearly, yes,
a long number of years.
Right, so in 1953, it was also at 2 minutes when we were testing the first hydrogen bombs. Yeah. So thermonuclear devices on the planet for the first time was enough to set it to 2 minutes. But yes, when it was set to 2.5 minutes, some of what was said was this was the first time that the clock had ever been moved based on a single person, and that was our President Trump. Mm-hmm. So they took a range of things into consideration. They consider not just the state of nuclear weapons, but also climate change and emerging technologies is a category that they also include.
this possibility for disrupting governments, elections, things like that, infrastructures.
Yeah, so they meet for quite some time. They talk about how difficult it is to kind of put try to quantify how close we are to the apocalypse, because of course midnight is the apocalypse, and that's nothing to trifle with. But they take their position very seriously, and they feel like it's less about a completely accurate prediction. The accuracy isn't the point. It's whether we're actually at 2 minutes before the apocalypse. It's that we are in a very, very dangerous situation. Also want to emphasize that which direction is the hand moving.
Yeah.
So they're more interested in that than the actual 2 minutes part. But so to say that we've moved it to a more dangerous place than even 2017. Yeah. And they cite things like the Nuclear Posture Review. It hadn't been formally released when they made this announcement, but it had been leaked, and they saw things that were talked about here, like the usable nukes and using nukes in other situations besides being fired on first. So quite a few considerations, and this is how dire their assessment of the state of affairs is with this move.
It's interesting that the people who do the bulletin mm-hmm. are also the people who invented the bomb.
Mm-hmm. So.
And I've heard about this pretty much all of my life. Sometimes it's more prominent than others. Like past years, I had not heard much about it. And all of a sudden, now it's back.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So after the fall of the Soviet Union, I guess it backed off a few, at least some
minutes. 14, I think.
I read the timeline from their materials about from the beginning when they created this. And it has been like an up and down thing.
Yeah.
But the best thing was after the Cold War, we had the potential. But then it ramped back up again because we didn't live up to the potential, and we started doing stupid crap again, mm-hmm. but it had some ups and downs. But boy, they're really in panic mode here now.
Yeah, if I could read a brief quote from the bulletin, folks. This is a letter from Rachel Bronson, PhD, the board member, the chair of the board.
Yeah.
Although the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists focuses on nuclear risk, climate change, and emerging technology, the nuclear landscape takes center stage in this year's clock statement. Major nuclear actors are on the cusp of a new arms race, one that will be very expensive and will increase the likelihood of accidents and misperceptions.
So. You know, and we haven't even talked about that. We've talked about people's recklessness and
mm-hmm,
stuff,
mm-hmm.
but accidents, you know, anytime you have something complex, there are lots of things that can go wrong with that. And accidents and miscalculations and computer errors and all kinds of stuff could do us in when you have these risky things on hair trigger. We talked a bit about this deterrence thing, and one of you a couple days ago when we were doing a speaking engagement mentioned that this deterrence thing is like, imagine two men in a room full of gasoline and gasoline fumes, and one guy has four matches and the other guy has two matches, you know, and it's like, boy, I'm more secure because I got four matches, you know.
And it is that kind of insanity.
Yeah.
It's the crackpot realism that C. Wright Mills talked about. And
it's clearly, a disregard for humanity. I mean, these are weapons of mass destruction. We talk about how, we went to war against Iraq to get rid of them, supposedly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yet we threaten the world with them.
Yeah, yeah. And so it's a lack of empathy, a lack of being able to see things like the rest of the world sees it. And the world is fed up with us. And in just a couple of minutes, we'll talk about some great actions through the United Nations. I want to mention something about religious positions opposing nuclear weapons. We've been talking a lot about the problems, but there are some solutions. One is, before we get to the United Nations and some other things, people of faith who appreciate this beautiful world that God created for us, and the human beings and the plants and the ecosystems and stuff, we want to protect all this. We want to be able to survive and thrive. And a great many religious bodies worldwide and religious leaders strongly oppose nuclear weapons. And they've got statements, a number of them have issued statements. A lot of religious bodies have affiliated religious peace fellowships that are connected with the national level of the Fellowship of Reconciliation. And you can see the list at www.forusa.org and look for the religious peace fellowships. They've issued statements from a lot of faiths are posted at a link that I'll provide through my blog if people want to check that out. Pope Francis on November 10, 2017 spoke to a high-level conference about nuclear weapons. He was very bold and explicit in denouncing nuclear weapons, and he had previously urged the United Nations to abolish all nuclear weapons. Desmond Tutu called for a disarmament race, and there are just lots and lots of statements from religious groups across the spectrum, Jewish, Muslim, Buddhist, Christian, everybody, you know. So at the heart level, as well as the head level, we can do a lot better than what we've been doing. I want to also put in a plug to urge Congress to pass S-200 and H-R-669 that would prevent Trump or any president from starting a nuclear war and restoring the constitutional checks and balances. Trump really seems to be actually insane. He has no impulse control. He's really ignorant about nuclear weapons, but his finger is on the button, and he has the power to do it if he feels like it. The Constitution says the president can't start a war, only Congress can declare a war. But since 1945, when World War II became a war with atomic weapons against Japan, we've got kind of a de facto loophole in that only Congress can declare war, but if you want to have the biggest, most horrible war that'll blow up the world, well, the president can do that without going through Congress. And H.R. 669 and S-200 would restore the checks and balances of the Constitution.
So this would limit a first strike by the president.
This is for the first strike. Yeah, this would not prohibit retaliation if there's an actual attack on us. But this is the first strike that it would prohibit. And we need to convince Congress to do that. And we've talked, people from our local committee have talked to the staff members of Maria Cantwell and Patty Murray, the two U.S. senators from our state, and neither of them has gone along with this. Our committee did convince our 10th Congressional District Representative, Denny Heck, to sign on. But I just want to urge people, wherever you live in this country, urge your senators to support S-200 and urge your representatives to support H.R. 669. We need that more than ever, and that would be an ongoing remedy, not just when you have a madman in the White House.
And that would add at least some of the balance the framers intended when they wrote the Constitution.
Yeah, they could not have anticipated nuclear weapons.
They were very concerned about executives starting wars.
Yeah. There's all kinds of constraints and checks and balances, and this is the biggest, most recklessly dangerous loophole imaginable, and we need to fix that.
And it's just a window into the nature of nuclear weapons that you have to launch them before the weapons that you think are coming at you hit. Yeah. And so you have this really very short response time. And it's just a recipe for disaster.
Yeah, we refer to the hair trigger a little.
And it's especially dangerous because apparently the Russians don't have the capability to see things as soon as we do, so their window is even shorter. Ours, I think, is 30 minutes. I think the Russians is like 5 or 10 minutes.
Yeah. Tim, can you tell us about some of the exciting progress from the United Nations General Assembly?
Yeah, well, if we're talking about the UN weapons ban that was agreed to in last July, 2017, it was initiative led by an organization, ICAN, International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. And they are European. Started up, my understanding is, based on the landmine treaty efforts. And so it's really kind of an end around, recognizing that the nuclear nations haven't made any progress. The NPT, that is the Non-Proliferation Treaty conferences, have really not gone well as of recent, and so this is an attempt for the nuclear have-nots to have a say.
Yeah.
And it was fantastically successful in the sense that these nations were able to come together and draft an agreement in a relatively short period of time, in a couple of weeks, and then overwhelming support that I think you were saying.
122 nations signed this thing to ban nuclear weapons. And on the first day that it was available for actual signing, a few months later, 50 nations signed it the first day.
Yeah.
So they did this through the General Assembly of the United Nations, where it's democracy, where every nation has one vote. In the Security Council, that the rich, powerful nations, including those of us with nuclear weapons, have veto powers. It never would have gotten anywhere there. But they did this through the General Assembly, and this shows world democracy wanting to ban nuclear weapons.
Now three nuclear nations signed on the draft for that.
Which did you have in mind today?
Which nations they were, I don't know, but it's significant that three, that even three nuclear nations would sign on. This is the draft of that.
Yeah, that was not the final version, but the early, because none of them signed on to the final one. But I thought that was exciting, and I'm glad you mentioned the landmine treaty, because we do have in our world the history of banning whole categories of weapons. In 1972, the world banned biological weapons. In 1993, the world banned chemical weapons. And in 1997, the world banned landmines. So we've done this before, and the world is just fed up with these nuclear nations failing to abide by the Non-Proliferation Treaty from 1970.
And what they're not abiding by is the fact they're supposed to be moving toward disarmament. And clearly, if you read the the Nuclear Performance Review, that they're moving in the opposite direction. So it's good to see the nations of the world are saying, no, we don't want this.
Right. There's another neat thing that the UN General Assembly accomplished, and that's on November 1 of 2017, the General Assembly scheduled its first high-level conference on nuclear disarmament for mid-May of 2018. And so we need to pressure our governments, no matter where you live in the world, to make that a significant thing. So tell us more about ICAN. You mentioned the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons that was the driving force to get this through the UN. And they won the Nobel Peace Prize for this.
Yes, very exciting.
This is so cool.
Yes, really very relatively small organization with not a great length of time that they'd been in existence, but they're a coalition. So they were using the energy of all of the other, many of the other organizations working on nuclear disarmament throughout the country, including some local organizations. Physicians for Social Responsibility has been very active in Western Washington, and the Ground Zero Center for Nonviolence that is situated next to the Bangor subbase and has been very active on calling attention to
Kitsap County, just 60 miles from Olympia.
So both of those organizations are part of the coalition, and and I think the entire nuclear disarmament community, it felt a great pride and legitimacy, things that we struggle for, because there is so little media attention to this issue. And even that winning the Nobel Peace Prize, not a lot of media attention.
The media always seems to be geared toward reinforcing whatever the national politics, the national party line. I don't mean Republican or Democrat, because we have bipartisan foreign policy that supports nuclear weapons, but just the nationalism, and the media line up behind that, and they don't really want to say, hey, there's another way to think about things besides nationalism.
Doesn't ICAN include about 100 countries?
Includes many organizations. I'm not sure what the country level sponsorship
is. I heard 100 countries and then all those different organizations within those countries.
I want to put in a plug for the statewide organizing. You mentioned the Washington Physicians for Social Responsibility. And early in 2017, this organization, which is doctors and other medical professionals and just ordinary people, created a statewide coalition of a rapidly growing number of organizations and individuals to work against this new arms race that we've been talking about. And the Washington Physicians for Social Responsibility at WPSR.org is part of the national one, which is PSR.org, and part of the international one, the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War. And that organization won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1985. And so we invite people to connect. I've participated in all of the statewide meetings of the statewide coalition, which has a name, Washington Against Nuclear Weapons. And we'll have the at the end of the program, I can tell people how to contact them.
Yeah, I should say that there's been numerous Nobel Peace Prize winners who whose work was nuclear disarmament. So,
Obama.
Including him, yes.
Well, although he was mixed, because he
right on the one hand, but he opened the door.
He said he would do that, and it turned out he didn't.
So Tim, tell us about the Olympia group that we're all a part of here, that the viewers might not know about, the Olympia Coalition to Abolish Nuclear Weapons. So we're part of that statewide coalition.
Yeah, viewers, come join us. Yes. We're a bunch of fun folks who have, of course, our regular monthly meetings. We do some other, you know, sort of basic visibility kinds of things. We made a banner. We show it at freeway overpasses.
Yeah, and we'll show the photo of the, the banner, the Abolish Nuclear Weapons. You took the lead in organizing that, and a number of us have held it on all kinds of weather this winter.
Yeah, we've had a really great great involvement. Bob Delastrada here has worked to set up meetings that you mentioned just a few minutes ago with the staff of different senators, Cantwell and, and Murray, and felt like that was a good listening session.
Yeah, well, working with them, we want the senators to know that we're out here, and that we we try to hold them accountable to our agenda of trying to move towards nuclear disarmament. Yep. And of course, we were disappointed that they didn't sign on S-200, but we.
But they've been active. They send a letter with a couple of dozen other signatories to Trump in response to the nuclear posture review. So they've been, you know, more active than most members of Congress.
We're thankful for what they do, what they've done.
But the idea is to raise that consciousness.
That's
absolutely
right. And if we had more participation locally, more public awareness and visibility and pressure, we could push these folks to do better, because we've done a lot of different things. You know, there's been some work at the city of Olympia level, a lot of signature gathering. David Billings and others have worked on signature gathering.
Yeah, David and Chris have done a great job with that.
And Chris Carson, information sessions, film showings, all kinds of stuff we've got going on. And we intend to continue doing this, so that's good.
We've spoken to a church congregation most recently and are available to speak to others.
Yes, so we're looking for speaking engagement. Yeah. People can contact us, and we'll do that. They can email us by going to by emailing nuclearweapons@olympiafor.org, and I'll have my contact information at the end of the program as well.
And I should say, we're feeling pretty good about ourselves these days with the Nobel Peace Prize, with Denny Heck becoming a co-sponsor to the No First Use, and our meeting with him.
But he wasn't very receptive at first.
It's very true.
Yeah,
it's very true.
Yeah.
But, you know, this is a tough issue, and we absolutely need people's help and creative ideas. We have regular meetings. Please contact Glenn or myself.
Yeah.
Glenn will provide that information, I think, at the end of the
show.
But we, you know,
we have to get the information out there, because after the Cold War ended, it just kind of, this issue kind of went underground. Everybody just assumed that, well, we have no more problem with nuclear weapons. Well, that has raised its head again.
So we're just about out of time. I want to let people know that there's a lot of information available from a lot of sources, a lot of organizations, and I'll mention just a little bit now, and then with the closing credits, I'll mention websites you can visit that'll get you connected. So if you visit www.parallaxperspectives.org, you can either click the TV programs link or the nuclear weapons link, and look for the title of this program, which is Nuclear Weapons Updates, Dangers and Opportunities. And then that'll be a link for watching this program, but also that same posting is a link to read a very thorough summary of what we said during this hour. At the end of that, there will be several pages of lists of information sources, organizations, publications, quotations from religious leaders, articles about the nonproliferation, or not the, about the nuclear posture review, and a bunch of stuff. I mean, there's a lot of information there at that resource. So visit www.parallaxperspectives.org, click either TV programs or nuclear weapons, and then look for this program titled Nuclear Weapons Updates, Dangers and Opportunities, and then the thorough summary of what we said will have stuff, including some other foreign policy contexts and relevant peace groups and so forth. I want to thank our three well-informed guests. It's fun to work with you guys, and I'm glad we had a chance to do this. Bob Delastrada and Mark Fleming and Tim Russell. I want to thank all the folks who've been watching. The world has many serious problems, and they may seem daunting, but as serious as they are, a lot of people are actually working to solve these problems, including us here, and lots more people who we could not fit in the studio because there are millions more. So we really need more people to work with us to prevent nuclear war from destroying all life on Earth. We need more people to nonviolently pressure our government and other governments to abolish nuclear weapons. The task is difficult, but it's possible if we work hard and if we work smart. And our committee is fun to work with, and I think are working hard and working smart. You can get information about a wide variety of issues related to peace, social justice, and nonviolence at www.parallaxperspectives.org. That's my blog, or you can phone me at 360-491-9093, and I can refer you on to information sources that you need. We are all one human family. We all share one planet. We can create a better world, but we all have to work at it. And the world needs exactly what you have to offer.